שלום לכם. מוקדם יותר שמענו על מודלים מגוונים לתקשורת המדע, שזה כמובן יפה מאוד בתיאוריה, אבל מה זה אומר בפועל? מי שתעזור לנו להבין איך המודלים הללו באים לידי ביטוי בשטח, היא המדענית והסופרת שריל קירשנבאום. שריל מנחה תוכנית אינטרנטית בנושא מזון ברשת PBS, והיא גם המנכ"לית של עמותת Science Debate, שפועלת לקידום מדיניות המדע והטכנולוגיה בארצות הברית. וכדי שנוכל לשוחח, אעבור עכשיו לאנגלית. Shalom and welcome to Sheril Kirshenbaum, scientist, author, host of Serving Up Science on PBS Digital Studios, and executive director of the non-profit, non-partisan organization Science Debate. Hello, Sheril.
Shalom. Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, thank you for coming. So my first question is, often scientists have an image of science communication as a format in which they are talking about their research and the audience is being enriched and informed, but research and experience tell us this is not always the case. Why is that?
Well, what you describe we call the deficit model, where scientists expect that we just tell our audience a lot of facts and they'll learn from that and remember it and be more enlightened in the process. And that's just not the way humans work. So what is a lot more effective is finding ways to engage with our audience. So we're not just talking at them, but listening to each other, having a conversation, and they're coming away with answers to the kinds of questions they might have, but not otherwise have the opportunity to talk about.
So you used, for example, dialogical approaches to science communication in roundtable discussions where farmers and food experts and health professionals and community members talked about food. What was the purpose of these discussions?
The purpose is exactly what I was discussing in the last point. It was, I've been at 5 different universities, and so often what we do is we talk at the audience. We show up, we're there for a keynote, and we take off. Instead, with these roundtable discussions, we want to bring our community together, which means that it's not just the scientists that are there to present. It is, in our case, since it's about food, it's farmers, it's doctors, it's people in the community involved in agriculture, maybe urban planners. And then we have a real conversation, and suddenly it's a bigger, more impactful event than it would have been if I or someone else from a university just showed up, told people what to do and what to think, and left. A lot of people have thought that worked historically, but the results haven't suggested that that's effective.
But do all stakeholders have to have like a minimal science education or science information in order to participate, or each person brings their own lay expertise which might not be related to science in any way?
The latter. So we'll have experts from our university, maybe experts from the health profession, different spaces like that, experts in agriculture. But we'll also have people in the community who might not know so much about a topic, or who come with their own perspective, maybe opinions on something that might be a bit more informed if they listen to us. So some of our topics are not controversial. Maybe everyone's there to learn about landscape and agriculture, but sometimes we talk about things like genetically modified foods or how climate change is shifting our menus. And those tend to be a lot more engaged, excited, sometimes loud conversations where not everyone's on the same page, but hopefully we come away, I come away often learning something from our audience, which hopefully the community is as involved, if not more, than I am by the end of the event.
So on another note, you also direct Science Debate, which asks politicians and elected officials to pay more attention to science policy. Isn't that dangerous to the freedom of scientific research to have politicians too interested in science policy?
Well, Science Debate has been around since 2007, and we got started in the 2008 US presidential election. And the purpose has never been to tell politicians or candidates running for office how to feel about a specific topic. It was just formed by a group of citizens, some in science, some outside of science, who felt like prior to an election, we hear a lot about the economy, we hear a lot about national security, we hear a lot about such a variety of issues that are going to impact our lives, and yet we weren't hearing very much about where they were on scientific issues, whether it's space exploration or biodiversity or ocean conservation, any number of issues. So it's simply, it's a nonpartisan ask that when you're running for office, talk about this, voters are listening. So we never push an agenda with that organization. We never tell politicians what side is right or wrong. We simply listen, and then we publish what they have to say.
In the recent decades, you used very different models of science communication. You disseminated information and ideas using the media. You engaged with many stakeholders in science-based dialogue, and you had elected officials participating in science-related policymaking. What are the strengths and limitations of each of these models?
I think that might be the wrong question. I think that the audience is so important when you're thinking about what's effective. Mm-hmm. So I often speak at universities. I often speak to people in policy. I also often speak to children. My own kids are both under 10. And so when I'm going to work with a specific group, I'm really trying to understand the cultural context of what they're familiar with, what kinds of issues they might be hearing about, what kind of language they're comfortable with. And then as I keep repeating, but I think is really fundamental and the most important part of science communication, I really try to focus on the listening part to figure out how to approach that group. And so I think many different things can be effective depending on who you're visiting that day.
Okay. Sheril Kirshenbaum, thank you so much for talking with us today. We will meet again towards the end of the course to discuss science communication with policymakers.
Thank you so much.